Oh my God. Hi, welcome to Politics for People Who Hate Politics. One of those special episodes that mean I don't need to remember what number we're actually on, because who knows anymore. This special episode is devoted to talking about fiction and libertarianism and ideology and things like that and how they kind of mix together. And I have I have none of my staples, so I'm even more nervous and forgot how to do all this. It's going to be fine. It's going to be good. We have Adam Berkeley, who is my friend, and I met him in history class long ago. We talked about socks. His official life bio is more, he recently moved to Tacoma, Washington, and I think he likes it better than up New York City. And he is a strength coach, and he occasionally thinks about politics, but apparently he's been ignoring them lately, and that's probably good. Welcome back, Adam. You were
Thank
on
you.
Like last year. It's always good to see your face in the world. We have David Kirk West. I'm going to give him his proper bio due here. Anarcho-capitalist libertarian filmmaker from Southern Oregon. I hear he's in Texas right now. He writes, directs, cinematographies, and edits several fictional narrative short films. Many libertarian themes in there. He wants to make it mainstream someday, but mainstream and anarchist, of course. I met him once in real life after he yelled at John Bolton, and then we all booed John Bolton, and it was the best, and I give him full credit for the fact that John Bolton has chosen not to run for president. It's all David's doing. Well done, David. It's all your doing. Okay.
Did he actually choose not to? I was kind of hoping he would, because my video might have a resurgence in views after that, and I'd be able to get some more money from it.
Yeah, but the best part is him not running, because I mean, we can all assume he would never get anywhere, but also he's a frightening man.
Well, and if he did, I might have to take things a step or five beyond yelling at him. So
let's just leave that to
him
menacingly in the air. Okay, and we have also Bridget Burns, and I'm very excited that they decided to come on even without Kelly, the security blanket. And Bridget, what do? You just make me happy on the internet, but I don't really know what you do in life beyond that. Officially, writes things, and they write a neglected film blog. Cinema chicanery. Chicanery is a good word. And Twitters, I will let you do your own Twitter thing a little bit later. Oh, and your beefs. Your beefs are war, empire, drug war, and prohibition. Hey, me too. Lack of sex worker rights, lack of trans rights, prison beefs. People always give me longer bios, and I always butcher them horribly. I'm sorry about that. And they are also an amazing friend to AnnaWar.com, which I really appreciate. So welcome.
What's going on?
I'm glad you're here, even without Kelly.
Me too.
Good. Okay. After all of that biographying, let's get down to it, gentle folks. Did you guys read the horrible Firefly essay that I sent round? It was kind of old, but I had never seen it before.
Before we get into it, have we ascertained that it is, in fact, a serious piece and not some sort of parody?
Thank you. I wondered the same thing.
I'm going to say that, like, a libertarian... Libertarians aren't usually that deft in their parody, bless them.
We tend not to be very subtle.
Not most of the time. It was perfectly... In line with certain types of mainstream liberal thought. The idea that the main characters in Firefly, the Joss Whedon classic show, and the movie Serenity, they're the bad guys. But not only that, because I think the narrative admits they're anti-heroes, but that the Alliance are basically good. And that's where it gets even more dicey, I think, for obvious reasons.
I think it was a I'm sure there was some element of humor to it, and they know, obviously, that the Alliance is kind of evil. But I think it was a fairly, true or, real article. And it's not the only one I've seen. Last summer, I think, Cracked.com did a Today's Topics video with all the exact same points.
It was bad, too.
Yeah. I almost think you posted that at one point. I almost think that was when you first brought this up, but maybe it wasn't.
Most Cracked videos are really bad. It's kind of odd.
I love Cracked.
I love Cracked, but most of their videos suck. They have great writing, but most of the videos, except the ones where those people are in the diner being weird.
After Hours? Oh, well, I mean, After Hours is by far
the best.
Those
are pretty funny.
Yeah.
I mean, from just like a strength and conditioning health perspective, the Cracked things are just, it's just really annoying. So I can't say I love Cracked at all.
Cracked is not to be depended upon for accurate information, I think.
People actually listen to that advisory because they don't.
Well, it's like a sensible, I mean, you can just infer the lack of dependability.
I wish that the inference was actually something that people could draw.
When the top banner says the internet's number one humor site, you gotta...
Right.
Assuming an article that's been written in list form, isn't that kind of an assumed risk?
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Very true.
It's like Austin Peterson articles.
Don't speak those words to me. Do not speak the words Austin Peterson.
They're like saying Mordor at night or something. Kind of.
So the article. One of the reasons why that article, the blog about Firefly, is totally sincere, I think, is that the mentality, it falls perfectly in line with this idea that anyone paranoid, anyone fringy in politics is more threatening than someone who extremely arguably coming from me, is too afraid of the government. I mean, FDR is a hero, and anyone, with a couple of guns in a bunker is, terrifying. That's just a mainstream liberal idea, and it applies here. Maybe the Alliance does give health care, to certain people. Maybe it does a few nice, banal...
Provided you're close enough to the center of the Alliance, though.
Right, yeah.
Business is supplying medical supplies to people who can't get any.
Right.
I think there's this false equivalency in the article with legality and morality. And that's one of the more repugnant things I run into on a daily basis.
Definitely.
A liberal sense is that if something is legal, it must therefore be moral.
Well, that's not just a liberal thing. That's very much a conservative status thing, too.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone that has anything to gain from law and order is going to have that sense of morality of their so-called law and order.
But it's not just the morality, it's that things are forgiven in government. Like, the standards are incredibly low. So, FDR can be this heroic man who gave us nice things, and, interning 100,000 people without charge is, forgivable. But if somebody, Randy Weaver or somebody who is suspect for these fringy reasons... The standards for their behavior are much higher. Or even my behavior. I mean, I believe these crazy things, and I'm not to be trusted by certain people. But government, well, you take the good and the bad, even when the bad is, various war crimes, both fictional and in reality.
It's not perfect, but it's the best we have, Lucy.
Thank you.
I think I speak for everyone here when I say that.
You're right.
One of the most successful things that government does is it insulates people from those types of, for confronting those things.
Mm-hmm.
And that's their most successful tactic, is just insulation. And it makes it very easy to demonize, those people with their sort of esoteric or sort of outside of the mainstream views, especially if they have guns in a bunker and, maybe have a few questions about the way wars are conducted or various things. You know, comfort definitely talks to your average person.
Yeah.
Personally, you know, I think that the mere existence of that article speaks to one of the biggest reasons that I always cite for why I think that Firefly is one of, if not the best pieces of libertarian fiction ever created, and that is that the government it portrays and the Alliance is not just like a cartoon villain. I mean, you know, look at something like Star Wars, where they just kind of took a vague space Nazi aesthetic and, you know, they just had them going around murdering people and gave them no motivations, no extra depth. In Firefly, they show that, yeah, sometimes they take medicine to people. Sometimes, you know, there's guys like the people who board Mal's ship, and then when he ends up saving them, they let him go free. There's people who work for the Alliance who exercise some discretion, who aren't just completely awful human beings. I think that's why Firefly is so good as libertarian fiction, though, is because it basically portrays a fairly realistic government. And the big evil of the Alliance, in the end, isn't so much that it's a bunch of, you know, space Nazis that want to oppress everybody. The evil is that it's a bunch of bureaucrats who, you know, when you have a bureaucracy, you can spread the blame among so many people that nobody feels responsible for evils like, you know, the killing of 30 million people. And the whole point ends up being that they're evil, even though they're trying to make the galaxy a better place and make it safe and make people better.
That's what the woman says on the convenient plot message at the end of Serenity, is that we meant it for the best. And, you know, the whole thing, Joss Whedon's supposedly sort of a mainstream liberal, but the speech in Serenity at the end where Captain Mal is asking them to join him on what is basically a whistleblowing, you know, possible suicidal mission. It's totally about whistleblowing. His whole speech where he says, like, in 1 year or 10 years, they're going to try this again. They think they can make people better, and I do not hold to that. I mean, some liberal dude, you know, who invented Buffy the Vampire Slayer managed to put, like, my most cherished beliefs in the mouth of a space captain, like, second-tier Han Solo. So, yeah, I do love that movie.
It definitely speaks to his ability as an artist. You know, to be able to create a character that has maybe differing beliefs from himself, you know.
Yeah.
Everything, I think, things just like J.J. Abrams, there's a little bit too much hero worship with these guys. But I can appreciate the ability to hold someone else's ideas in your mind and present them in a format that people who hold those ideas actually resonate with.
Well, yeah, that's kind of the big question. I mean, Serenity... Well, the pilot of Firefly has that line about that's what government's for, get in a man's way. But Serenity has that perfect Mal speech, and it also has River Tam literally summing up the state, in my opinion, which is it's old man covered in blood, and like never touched them, but they're drowning in it. Like, Jesus Christ, what is that except for the state? That is the state.
She also explains at the very beginning when they're having the sort of flashback to her in, like, grade school, she explains to the teacher that people hate the Alliance because they meddle.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a fantastic... I mean, there's so many libertarian moments in that movie.
But those are so good that I'm almost like, how can a liberal be that good? And that... It's overt. I mean, we're not, you know... desperately trying to find these messages out of, like, these subtle things. That's some really overt stuff. I don't know if Tim Minear had anything to do with the movie, because he was supposedly the producer and writer, and he was actually kind of libertarian on the show. I honestly don't know, though.
I think my favorite moment of government incompetence is in the pilot with the undercover agent that boards as a passenger.
Mm-hmm.
He's stern, he's forceful, he doesn't listen, he doesn't know how to use the gun he's been issued. Somebody gets hurt, and they end up finally just killing him. It's a very satisfying story.
That's good.
All right, so not to mention, they kill him in the best way possible.
Yes.
We can spend the entire time talking about how amazing Firefly is. Now, there are two broader questions to branch out into from this, though. One is sort of as libertarians, or Adam is sort of... You're close enough for government work, as the saying goes. I don't want to give you a title that you reject, Adam. I think that you're...
I have a title. I like to be a person of conscience.
This is not a diss. I'm granting you the nuance that you request.
Or anything. Just I like to think about shit. Yeah. So.
But basically, it's people who want people to be more free. In lots of areas. Let's do that. Is fiction kind of the place to have this, and whether it's like inferred libertarianism, which are something like The Hunger Games, Star Wars maybe, the show Jericho by the second season got at least very sort of Tea Party-y and not the most vomitous way. Like, is... Well, I don't know. There was a lot of, like, Revolutionary War allusions that were on purpose, but were really satisfying. So many spoilers in this podcast. Like, is fiction a good place to put these types of messages? And, like, how overt should they be? I think a lot of sort of self-published libertarian ebook on Amazon type stuff is really bad. Meanwhile, liberal Josh Whedon gives us this lovely, lovely stuff. I don't know. Like,
I mean, granted, self-published stuff in general is just bad, so let's not totally blame that on.
Right, no, I know. But generally, I mean, I've watched some Christian movies.
Why?
Sometimes by accident. I don't, sometimes by accident, sometimes because I wanted to watch a movie that was...
How many Christian accidents have you had now, Lucy?
Like, I watched the movie God Is Not Great, which is basically just like an email.
God's Not Dead.
Sorry, you're right. God Is Not Great is totally different.
Totally different kind of Christian.
And like, I'm not, David, I believe you are a Christian, and I'm not mocking, but merely that these movies are usually quite awful because the messaging...
Lack of subtlety,
you know, they're just awkward. And they're all about sending a very overt ideological sort of world message. And I know people who think libertarianism should try to sneak into the culture more, but I don't know if we know how.
Trust me,
to not be instructive or didactic about it. And it's a hard urge to resist.
Totally. I mean, I trust me, as a Christian and a filmmaker, you will not find anyone who hates your typical Christian film more than me. I am a vitriolic critic of, you know, pretty much anything Sherwood Baptist Church, for example, puts out. And the problem with most of those films, and it's the similar problem that we see with a lot of libertarian films, is that with these Christian films, you usually have, like, a pastor, somebody who wants to tell a sermon, set out to make a film. They say, oh, I want to make this sermon. How do I put this into a film? Instead of it simply being a filmmaker who happens to be a Christian making a movie that his views are, of course, in. You know, and that's, I don't know if any of you are familiar with, like, Alongside Night, from J. Neil Schulman, but it's like that same problem with that. Like, this guy set out to make this libertarian film, and it's just not good. I'll leave it at that. So when you have, like, ideologues setting out just to convey a message instead of first and foremost tell a good story, you're going to end up with a shitty film.
To cover what... just as like a sort of libertarian outsider, not part of like the coterie of the libertarian writing, I think one of the problems that you see with a lot of people doing libertarian writing or even trying to create libertarian art is I think there's this sense that it's so obvious that what we think makes sense. And I think the frustration that other people are just don't get it or think you're crazy or, you know, deny it, it's really hard to overcome that when you are setting out to put a message out there. You know, that's something that I see all the time. You have conversations and people will start being like, but it's just so obvious. And I'm like, well, I know that, but other people don't. And just say so obvious.
You need to wake up, man.
It's no different than people being very irritated by people trying to talk about their religious beliefs and feeling like they're being pressured. Instead of just having an open conversation, I believe this. This is why it makes me feel. You get this sort of like, how do you not see that this is real? And I think I understand the temptation and the difficulty in not doing that, but I do think that's an issue. It's an issue, I think, on all sides of politics when you get into any kind of art and adding your political. I mean, liberals are horrible at that, right?
Mm.
And, you know, conservatives are just as bad as well. You look at John Wayne, right? I mean, John Wayne took a sledgehammer and tried to hit conservative values through your head. And, you know, however you feel about John Wayne, it's very obvious, and he couldn't help himself. It's just that difficult. It seems so clear that you're right.
And where is he now?
He's dead, probably, maybe because of the above-ground testing and the movie that was filming downwind from it. I don't know if that's really true or not. But he is dead. You're right about that. He's extremely
John
dead.
Wayne confirmed for dead.
John back. Terrifying. That's like I saw something with Reagan there using the Reagan. It's like, oh, he's dead. Let him be dead, please.
Also, he was desperately overrated in every way that they.
Of course, that's true. I mean,
he was less of a warmonger than than he could have been, but. They like warmongers, most people who worship Reagan, so they should be dissing him for that.
I think for me, one of the most, on a tangent about just presidents, and is this idea that, like, how many truly great presidents have we actually had?
None.
That's exactly.
Not
enough. And so it's this thing of where, like, the desire for the national father is so strong that you can be even have an iota of charisma and you become a great president.
Yeah, it's awful. We're doomed. But I mean, the tangent impulse is strong. But if you want to communicate a message and a belief, like, how can you help yourself when it comes? I mean, how can you be subtle when you just want to, like, lecture everybody about freedom or Jesus or, you know, various conservative values or anything that you, like, really want the people to know?
I think you just shouldn't want to lecture people. You should want to tell a story, entertain people, excite them, whatever, and, you know, teach them something along the way, sure.
Mm-hmm. But the problem, though, is almost like, do we need liberals to tell libertarian stories? I mean, do we need... Like, Joss Whedon or, I don't know, I mean, The Hunger Games, we can talk about a little bit. The Hunger Games, the message is much more subtle. But to me, the final book, which everybody hated, comes with kind of with the message that you may have this really justified revolution because you have this really hideous state, and your war, like, could not be more justified, and you go through all these horrors, and you get rid of this government, and oops, the new government wants to do the exact same things. And there's a very rare message there that I think is really good. And that may not be a libertarian one, but it's certainly about cautiousness in terms of both making war and making governments.
I've only seen the first two Hunger Games films, and I haven't read the books, but it doesn't really strike me as overtly libertarian.
It's not overtly. I don't think anyone knows that woman's politics. The movies are actually better, I think, thanks to Jennifer Lawrence.
They definitely are better.
Yeah.
You know what's funny is I actually...
Like your classic leftist revolution because everything seems so class-focused.
I actually almost completely disagree with you guys here. I think Hunger Games is, like, very overtly libertarian. I mean, this is dwelt on a little bit more in the book, but in the first book, there's, like, a whole page or two devoted to explaining how welfare is just used to control people.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, they talk about how there's these things called the tesserae, which is like food that the government gives them,
mm-hmm.
like a certain amount of food rations. And Katniss is basically telling Prim, her sister, don't accept those. They use it to get you dependent on them. And like it went through this whole big thing talking about why welfare is dangerous. There's parts where PETA and Katniss sit together talking about know, PETA explains to Katniss, like, they can't do this to us. Like, I own myself. He basically outright says that.
Yes.
And that coupled with the fact that the message in the final book ends up being, oh, yeah, all governments are bad, even the one that overthrows the previous oppressor.
That's my favorite.
I think that's pretty explicitly libertarian.
Yeah, it's very much... it's very much framed in the terms of like the old mining store in the book, in the sense of like how the mining company basically owned you because you had to buy everything at the store. I think that that for a lot of people you have to think about it in the he's obviously thought about it, seen the libertarian, but I think a lot of people probably miss that because they make such an association between, you know, the district and the qualities in the district, and then they're sort of controlled by the government. Because I actually remember thinking, oh, it's like you know, Western Pennsylvania mines, which I know you're familiar with. But I think one of the problems that you have is that because there's so few overtly libertarian works of art in the mainstream, it's very easy to find those things or look for them. And they really want them to be there. That games definitely has some overt libertarian in it. I also think the thing that's interesting is that we always feel the need to find out what the person's politics are, and I'm not always sure that's important to whether or not those messages are there and whether or not those messages have any impact.
Well, the messages can be there, and they can have an impact even, again, if a liberal or someone not what we believe is communicating them, but people can get very different things out of fictional worlds, and they can read something as very leftist when we wouldn't, perhaps.
And like, I think it's also. Go ahead.
Is a general sentiment of sort of like, yay, freedom? Is were that really enough to get the point across?
Hashtag.
I think it's also worth noting, this is another reason why I think The Hunger Games is fairly explicitly libertarian, is that the capital is basically portrayed as this sort of opulent capitalistic government.
Right.
Capitalistic. Whereas District 13, the rebel government that ends up being revealed to be pretty evil in itself, is sort of portrayed as more of a stark socialistic government. So I think it's really interesting that she chose to portray basically the two sides of the political coin when it comes to the two governments. So I don't know. Maybe I am just reading all this into it because I am an anarchist, but I see it there. I don't know how you make a story where the message ends up being all governments are bad without presenting any kind of alternative to it, without it being essentially anarchist.
That's well argued. I don't know. Do we have are there other fictional things? We haven't gotten it into books because none of us can read clearly. with libertarian messages, is there anything else that has always? You know,
South Park, the movie, was pretty libertarian.
Well, that doesn't count because they are libertarians. I mean, more or less. Like, they're basically, they call themselves more or less libertarian, overtly.
We're looking for works of art by libertarians with a libertarian message. It's kind of them and Ayn Rand at this point, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true. And Ayn Rand is a whole other problem because the lack of subtlety and the browbeating is all there in Rand.
You know, one film that I've always considered to be very libertarian and actually extremely subversively anti-war is one that I think gets overlooked a lot by libertarians, as being libertarian at least, is Red Dawn.
Man, please explain yourself.
Yes. Trust me. So everyone, like, I feel like most people remember Red Dawn incorrectly. They think it's like this fun, jingoistic piece of 80s Americana, like just Reagan America all the way. And I'm like, have you guys watched it recently? It's one of the darkest movies I've ever seen. It's about kids fighting a war, and in the end, they basically all die. There's very little humor in it. And John Milius, the writer and director of it, he's one of these guys that has some contradictory political views, but he has explicitly described himself as a Zen anarchist in the past. He has said straight up that it was supposed to be a metaphor for the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan that was taking place about the same time the movie was made. And so basically it's about how insurgent warfare is justified. There's a part where, you know, Jed Eckert, Patrick Swayze's character, is going to execute a Russian soldier they've captured, and one of the guys is like, how are we any different than them if you kill him? And he says, because we live here. It's pretty simple, but it's a property rights kind of message. And even Murray Rothbard even picked up on that in a review that he wrote of it. So the message ends up being basically like, invaders are bad, insurgents are good, owning guns is good. It's like the most pro-gun movie ever made. It literally has a line in the movie that bashes explicitly on gun registration. And not even just gun registration, but the 1968 Gun Control Act, which is when they started requiring background checks for guns bought from FFL holders. You have to fill out a form called a 4473. I've filled out many of these when I've bought guns. And there's a part where the Cuban commander tells his men, go find all the form 4473s, those exact words, and bring them to me so we can hunt down all the gun owners. And then they get put in re-education camps. So I think it's a very libertarian movie. And it's also really good to bring up because so many conservatives love it. And it's easy to point out, like, oh, yeah, so you think the Wolverines were good guys, right? And of course they say yes. And then you say, oh, guess what? They're just like the Iraqis and the Afghans and fighting American troops. So that's why I think it's important to view that film in a libertarian context.
Milius is definitely kind of
He's so contradictory.
I guess what Kevin Carson would refer to as a vulgar brutalist. He's also the guy that wrote the scripts to the first two Dirty Harry films, did Conan, and he was gloriously lampooned by his friends in the movie The Big Lebowski. The character is based directly off of Milius.
Wow. Wait, which character's Walter. Based on Milius?
John Goodman.
Really?
Yeah.
Google image search John Milius and you will see Walter Sobchak.
That's
like
funny.
Down to the haircut.
No, you know what's funny is that I knew that the Coen brothers were good friends with him and that they go out and like shoot on his ranch all the time and stuff. So that's funny. That makes sense.
That's I recently watched the remake of that movie finally, and it was such weak sauce compared to Red Dawn.
Such a missed opportunity.
You cannot recreate the conditions of the 80s, and then it's impossible. It's just there's all those films. I took a modern warfare class, and we spent a whole week watching all of the films from the 80s about the nuclear apocalypse.
I want to take that class.
Hilarious. Oh, it was amazing. It was this guy who teaches at the Naval War College. And that was one of those things. You just can't recreate those conditions where people are making these movies that are like, the end of the world is going to happen right now.
Mm-hmm.
With Afghanistan, it was the post-Vietnam, the bleakness of our foreign policy, post-Vietnam, post-Iranian Revolution, post-Tehran hostages. You can't recreate that in any way. And even economic downturns don't have the same effect as the thought of just the like weak armed American colossus of that time. It's not to say we want the strong arm America. That always works out well. But it's just like, you know, people will try to recreate these movies, and it's almost funny when they talk about modern movies as being gritty, because that almost inevitably means that they'll be rape, very vivid scenes of murder and torture, but they're not. It's not really gritty. It's just like it's just basically porn, violence porn, and I just think it's very interesting to analyze when they remake these 80s movies. It's just like it just doesn't have the same time.
Well, I mean, you can't make a movie. I mean, you can't make a movie from a time. You can't remake a movie that was very of its time, because when they were talking about remaking War Games, and like, what the hell would that movie even be? Because it's all about nuclear apocalypse, and oh my god, computers are weird, and look at the things they do, and they're also, you know, the size of a room and stuff, and can you, did you hear they can play chess, and like it's totally, it's not going to be the same movie in any way, even if you could sort of ape it. So that's,
you know, there's a movie that was remade recently, RoboCop, that had a lot of pretty poignant anti-war and anti-authoritarian flavoring to it, but it was just a bad movie.
What?
It's like four different movies that you don't care about jammed into one.
That's not good.
It was so bad I had to watch it twice to figure out how bad it was.
That's also a bad sign when that happens.
And then we were like, we have to watch that again because we full badness. And I completely agree with you. It was a very strange melange of a bunch of whatsoever. So
have any of you guys seen Shenandoah with Jimmy Stewart?
No.
What is it?
Shenandoah?
Shenandoah? Is it spelled that way, or is it spelled
Shenandoah? It's spelled that way. I don't know. Is that how you say it? I'm not from the South, so I don't know what you say.
I lived in Virginia for a while. It's Shenandoah.
Yeah. Okay, okay, I'll take. Thank you. I literally forget how to say it. Like every time I figure out how to say it right. Yeah. Anyway, it's a Civil War movie with Jimmy Stewart, and that is a very, very libertarian film. It has a very anti-war message.
Heard of that.
You know, it's an older film. It's from like 1960 or 65 or something. It's really good. It's really worth checking out. It has a very consistently anti-war message. The state of Virginia comes to try to draft Jimmy Stewart's sons, and he says, "No, you can't draft them. You know, were you the one that fed them? Were you the one that took care of them?" They try to confiscate his horses to use for the military, and he says, "No, it's my property." I mean, it delves very explicitly into a lot of property rights type stuff. And then the only reason that he ever ends up getting involved in the war is that the soldiers kidnap one of his sons while his youngest 12-year-old while he's out hunting or something. And so then he goes on the warpath to try to rescue his son. And it's a good movie. It's a very libertarian film too.
I think I have a clip of Jimmy Stewart saying something, like, it's just like a clip from the movie. I haven't watched the whole thing, but I found it in like Libertarian Wanderings once, and I meant to watch it. So I think.
Yeah, there's a couple great clips from it.
All right, Lucy, go ahead. Go ahead.
No, you go. You go. I was going to go.
Say if how we feel about Jeremiah Johnson. Are you guys familiar with that film?
Oh yeah, I love Jeremiah.
I know what
Johnson.
It is, but I haven't seen it yet.
I have a lot of buddies, so it's interesting. I have a few buddies that are ex-military. One of the most interesting things about ex-military guys is that they very quickly are like, you know, they very quickly come on sort of a libertarian path once they get out of the military. And Jeremiah Johnson is like a touchstone for those guys. Like, there's this sense of, like, it's interesting, a lot of the skills that they acquired in the military sort of leads them to this libertarian, I want my own space, I don't want government interference path, and Jeremiah Johnson really becomes a touchstone for those guys. Whether that's right or wrong, I don't know. I haven't managed to actually see the film except clips, but I just think it's interesting that comes up over and over and over. It's this sort of, like, lone man in the wilderness, and no one messes with me kind of thing, I was wondering if everyone was familiar with that and what you guys thought.
I've seen Jeremiah Johnson several times. I own it. It's a good movie, but I would actually say, as far as like stuff in that vein goes, The Outlaw Josie Wales is way better.
Yeah.
And of course, Clint Eastwood is kind of a libertarian. You know, like he's at least not a war hawk.
He's one of those people who like forgets to be libertarian sometimes without prompting.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Kind of like Glenn Beck. Who occasionally, if you remind him, libertarianism exists, Glenn Beck, and he's like, I'm a libertarian. And then they leave and he's like, conservatives, conservatism, blah. Like, he needs that, like, they need that reminder not to sort of fall into these sort of binary, bipartisan patterns or something. It's weird. I don't.
I actually have. I have a theory about the Clint Eastwood thing, because I've heard this before about his life. So, you know, Clint Eastwood was 15, right, when the war ended, when World War II ended.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's very difficult for those people, people of that age, not all of them, but people of that age, to sort of overcome the fear of war. I should have been there. I actually feel like that's one of the running things with Clint Eastwood in his war films, is this sort of sense that, like, that those guys are heroes and I should have been there. And I always feel like that's one of the things where he falls down on the libertarian thing, is that he kind of can't let go of the Greatest Generation. And
well, he's not alone with that. Served over there, but
wasn't he drafted to serve in the Korean War?
Yeah, but there's not, you know, the way the Korean War is viewed and the way that the World War II is viewed is, are definitely very separate things.
Mm.
So the World War II is the glorious fight against the evils.
I don't really get that vibe from Eastwood, but I definitely get it from John Wayne. You watch clips of movies like Scenes of Iwo Jima.
Mm-hmm.
Well, John Wayne is the sort of the classic, just the war movies are not about the questioning of the wars. And every time I watch something like The Americanization of Emily, which is the great Sheldon Richmond's like Memorial Day flick of choice, I forget that, you know, even back in the 60s, occasionally someone was critiquing even World War II. That barely happens now. At Reason, the commentators who love me deeply would give me all sorts of shit if I, you know, volunteered the idea that maybe you can't just nuke everybody, even if, you know, there are some bad people in the vicinity of where you drop the nukes. Maybe it doesn't work like that. Maybe you have to find a different way.
Well, I mean, that's also, I call that the grandfather syndrome. It's very hard to criticize something your grandfather was involved in. I think people find that very difficult to do.
Or with Gillespie, Reason, I think his father was going to be in the mainland invasion, and that was his, you know.
My grandfather, I felt like for a long time, is this sense of like, okay, save my grandfather, but then you have to look at it from a more nuanced perspective, you know.
Yeah.
But it's not easy to come to that place for a lot of people.
Yeah, and it gets very exhausting.
You're about John Wayne, because he was exempted from service. You can definitely imagine that feeling of like, oh, I really didn't get to do what I should have done, being America's toughest man.
Being named Marion didn't help. I mean, come on.
You know, hated John Wayne films was God, I'm blanking on his name. Dirty Dozen guy.
Oh, and now I'm blanking on it.
Lee Marvin?
Lee Marvin.
Yeah.
He served, and he saw some horrifying stuff, and he wasn't harsh about it, but he always kind of gave you the look when you'd ask him about John Wayne war films. And.
Mm-hmm.
Now I want to be a son of Lee Marvin even more.
Propaganda. I mean, it's just, yeah, this. Certainly, the sense of the propaganda. I mean, you look at the if you look at you know, the Green Berets, right? The famous John Wayne film, The Green Beret, and you know, that's such a not nuanced portrayal of the war in Vietnam, and the amount of guys that I've talked to whose fathers joined the military because of that movie is incredible. You know, you talk about like the chief propagandist for the military, John Wayne is right up there. And, you know, a lot of people went through a lot of hellish experiences because they bought what John Wayne was selling. So, you know.
Well, there's a happy thought. How many deaths is John Wayne responsible for?
Oh, God.
That's a website. But John is responsible for X deaths.
That doesn't seem quite fair. I'm not sure, though.
It's not fair, but
getting back to libertarian anarchist themes in films, it's not really what I would call a positive spin on libertarianism, but the character is such an obstructionist enemy of the state, is Snake Plissken in Escape from New York. He undermines authority at every single turn he's given the opportunity to.
I've only seen that movie once, so I'm kind of blanking on the finer points of it.
Well, at the very end of it, he's coerced. They inject these miniature explosives into his bloodstream, so he has to go in and save the president and retrieve this this summit tape with it's a 80s post-apocalyptic movie, but there's this summit tape with a peace conference message to prevent all-out nuclear war. And he asks the president, who he extracted and caused everyone else on the team to get killed, just want to ask you what you thought of everyone who gave their lives for him. The president kind of brushes him off. So you see him at the last minute, they play the summit tape, and it's like Glenn Miller or something. He switched the tapes on him, and you see him walking away into the darkness, pulling the magnetic reels out of this tape.
We may
have all well died after that incident, but...
You know what's funny is Kurt Russell's another one of these guys who claims to be a libertarian.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Pretty inconsistent about it, but he's claimed many times very publicly he is a libertarian.
Well, I don't remember... I mean, is he actually inconsistent? Like Bill Maher, he's inconsistent, or...?
Not that bad. Like, he's more like a Republican who... thinks drugs should be legal, there should be total gun rights, that kind of stuff. Like, but he's totally like pro-military. He said some really kind of horrifying things after 9/11. Some kind of like war type stuff. It is a shame, but he does seem to have a fairly libertarian philosophy on life, at least.
Well, I mean, the depressing caveat is that in a war and libertarian are not at all the same thing, and I sure wish that they were more the same thing.
Yes.
That's something to work on. I mean, after all, John Bolton, like, thinks he's a libertarian, remember? Sorry, I just really hate John Bolton.
I have heard now you brought up John Bolton.
I should never do that, I'm sorry. Just makes me want to boo things.
I mentioned it before. Let's just talk about Star Wars thing, because I can talk about that. But let's just talk about Star Wars as a one-dimensional...
No. Alright, so Star Wars.
And ultimately, the most interesting thing about Star Wars is, and this is the most frustrating thing about Star Wars, is in classic fashion, all of the best stuff in Star Wars is in the literature.
Right? So you claim. I've never read three of those books, so I can't...
Big mistake, you know. The most, like for instance, when you talk about, if you look at the newer films, which you shouldn't look at the newer films, but when you get into some of the novels written around the newer films, you start to develop this very interesting conversation about... the morality of using human beings, cloned human beings, and giving them no rights. Now, there's no morality to that. But that's not even discussed, right? Either just, oh, we have clones, how convenient. Or just talking about, like, with the Jedi and having these elites that are determined fully by their genetics, right? There's no... And they prop up an incredibly corrupt system. And also, ultimately, when, as the timeline moves on in Star Wars, just like in Hunger Games, the government that replaces the Empire, once that generation of like Leia and Han kind of, it's just as corrupt as the Empire ever was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's like there is this sort of sense of whether or not it's just like it's really a historical trend, like a human trend or what, that governments will inevitably decay towards corruption and being bloated and, you know. So I do think it's interesting because there is a lot of interesting political writing that has gone on in the Star Wars universe. It just happens to be outside of the mainstream. And it's kind of disappointing, honestly.
I think at least the original films themselves are so archetypal that you can't extract any meaningful political statement out of them at all.
You can debate the legitimacy of blowing up the Death Star as they do in Clerks and as we all have in our lives, probably. But the usual revolution and collateral damage type questions, but...
There's a great quote from everyone's familiar. People are familiar with Boba Fett, right? And he's Mandalorian, and actually the Mandalorians are like the libertarian.
Yeah. Oh, are they?
Really?
They live.
Is any of this still true, though, now that they're throwing yes. out the expanded universe?
All of my points. Thank you. I'm just going to gloss over that. But there's a great... the mercenaries are just basically like, the person is like, this person's world has been destroyed. The Empire in its early stages said he's a chemical weapon to obliterate the population of the person's world. And her Mandalorian basically says it's not going to affect the vast majority of the population of the galaxy. Only certain elites, or people who have what the Empire wants, are going to feel any pain from the Empire. And I think that sense of that's kind of the sense that people have about government in general is, why do I care? You know, if my, it's, you know, it goes back to the classic, like, they came for the other people, and but I think that's really something that is easy to overlook, that people, they're not affected by livelihood, the food on the table, their ability to have some beer and watch the Super Bowl is not affected. It's very difficult to communicate it. I actually think that's a have an impact on consciousness, because that is a that penetrates a sort of fog of comfort, or it can.
Well, that gets problematic, because, like, I don't want to condone, I don't even want to hope for bad things to happen to certain people, but when certain bad things happen to people that didn't usually happen to them, like Che Calvo, the mayor of somewhere little D.C. word, little suburb, he got, you know, an accidental drug raid, his dogs got shot, he's like a white dude mayor of somewhere. It's good for the cause of being against the war on drugs when that kind of thing happens to somebody, which is terrible, but it's totally true. And then it gets all dodgy because, like, you know, you people voted for certain horrible things, or you're letting it happen, so maybe, you know, sort of you're all at fault, and then maybe we should go break your windows and steal from the crony capitalists. And then it just gets into a problem.
The first thing that government's trying to do when they take over, like the famous Roman example of let's toss out the bread in circuses, the first thing that they try to do is bring as much comfort as to as many people as possible. Right? That's why they always talk about we need to reestablish security and stability. I mean, that's all that counterinsurgency, that's all that counterinsurgency ultimately is let's make sure that people can send their kids to school and they have full bellies.
Yeah.
They're paying attention to what's going on in the neighborhood. Mm. That's not the most nuanced looking counterinsurgency doctrine, but I've read enough of the field manuals to be able to talk about it a little bit.
I feel like I've lost my way in terms of these lovely tangents. Someone go on a tangent. Hurry.
Well,
is there a
since we're on the topic of Star Wars.
Star Trek.
That's right, Star Wars.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Yeah, Star Wars, please. Let's keep going.
Yeah, no. So since we're on the topic of Star Wars, what I will add, I'm actually hoping they'll introduce a little bit more depth and nuance to the new films, specifically because Finn, John Boyega's character, is a stormtrooper who turns, and as that has me really excited for a number of reasons. I mean, first of all, like, I'm a former soldier who turned conscientious objector, so I'm really curious to see where they go with that. And I think it's a very interesting move to make the hero a soldier who has a crisis of conscience. It'll be really interesting to see how deep that ends up being. I am hoping for probably more than they'll give us, but we'll see.
We all are. <those trailers>. And I don't even like J.J. Abrams, like, at all, movie-wise. So, honestly, I have no faith. Well, the other Star Wars one sounds good, too, but I hate that director, because that Godzilla was horrible. So, none of these directors I have faith in, but both all these movies seem and look so good.
My bar for Star Wars has been set so damn low after the last three that it will be impossible for me to not enjoy them.
That's the good attitude. It's like how I feel about the new X-Files miniseries. And I didn't even watch the whole damn thing yet. I'm going to, but like the seventh season gets real bad. So it's like, yeah, I've already seen a bad X-Files, so I don't feel like it's that dire. You know, like, I'll just let it be. What happens.
Are they getting the real-life inspiration for Dale Gribble back on that show, Robert Patrick, or is he just not?
I don't know, I hope not, because no one wants him back. They only want Scully and Mulder. Also, Dale Gribble is amazing. long before Ron Swanson and Captain Mal, we had Dale Gribble and his paranoia, and I wasn't supposed to find him as endearing as I totally did and do to this day. That's another. On another tangential note, the X-Files makes me feel too minarchist because it sort of implies that if you join the government, you can do good from the inside, which is not a message that I generally condone. So I don't know.
Speaking of Ron Swanson, was I the only one who was like heartbroken that he ended up working as a park ranger at the end of the series?
You were not, David. You were not the only one.
I was really hoping, since they kept doing the whole future thing, they would go somewhere really whacked out and have him like doing something like revolutionary or something. I don't know.
Of course,
I always hope for way too much.
Ron Swanson, Road Warrior.
Yeah. I mean, like, it could have been, you know, there are like more obviously like actively malevolent things in the government than the Park Service. Clearly, we all know that. But
right. Yeah.
I'm sorry. When I was watching it, I'm such a nerd that I was thinking about like the century of hideous mismanagement of Yellowstone and all the fuck ups about killing off all the predators. And then there were too many elk. And then the plants got fucked up. And all their fire policies. Like, I know this. I know it all. If you put out, you know, the little fires before they have a chance to burn the undergrowth, you eventually have a fire like they did in the 80s where like a third of the park burned down. That's what government running nature does. Government is so bad, it fucks up nature. And I think Ron Swanson, even though he loves nature, would know that. And the fact that he had a uniform on at the end, that was messed up. I'm sorry.
And they acted like that was like his dream come true. I was like, what the fuck is this?
They spent 7 years, and honestly, if he had insulted the government once during the seventh season, even then. But like, they spent 7 years basically saying it's okay that he likes Leslie, who's a giant statist, and Leslie likes him, even though he's a wacky libertarian, and they actually like each other, and they don't actually need to change, which was a pretty decent message for a show on NBC. And the message at the end turned out to be, actually, Ron does need to change, and he needs to go to Leslie for advice. And that was a bit of a betrayal.
Definitely.
I never watched that show. Out of my depth on the hill. I'm gonna watch.
Wait, what? Either.
I feel like I'm gonna watch this. The whole Ron Swanson drama.
Your mic is cutting out for me a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know if you need to be a little farther from it, Adam.
Let's see. No. I don't know. It's been giving me difficulty earlier today, so.
Pretty clear.
That was good. Yeah, that was good. Hold still, maybe.
Yeah, I'm an active guy, so.
The thing with Ron Swanson was fascinating because he was overtly libertarian as the character the whole time. And that was really interesting, and also because the humor on Parks and Recreation is very, it's not very mean, it's pretty damn warm and fuzzy at the end of the day. And Ron Swanson kind of was no more of a joke than any other character, so he was like gently mocked, but not more than anyone else. Like, even though he was this crazy mustache libertarian, and the characters like respected him and his sort of like cliched manliness, and like
right. Many times he ended up being the wisest character on the show more often than not, like explicitly. So yeah, actually, that was such a miscalculated decision.
I think man actually is a very interesting. Interesting, brings up very interesting stuff. Is I actually think that when you talk about, like, I actually think that cliched manliness ways at which libertarians are attacked.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely.
The goofy, you know, macho man, and I mean, there's definitely some degree in. I mean, it's minor in comparison with other gender issues And, you know, but there's definitely this thing in the culture of like, attack the manly man and mock him. Mm-hmm. And I think the libertarian values of like self-determination, self-reliance, general old freedom, that like cliche manly man, and it's very easy for some people to connect those values with libertarianism and mock them, you know, it's sort of in it, even though its absence is overtly absent, I should say. And I just find that interesting that those male libertarian characters, if they're even the tiniest bit libertarian, are frequently mocked for being, you know, kind of curmudgeon.
Mm-hmm. And of course, there are no female libertarian characters. We're definitely not there yet.
They don't exist.
No.
In, you know, self-determination and freedom, you know.
Ladies are not into that. Definitely not.
Will you ever see any like trans or sexual libertarian film? Seems very unlikely. Because it has to be a sexual, bearded, goofy guy with a gut and some bunker and some gun.
Or you have to be a, you know, Captain Mal. You have to be like a Han Solo trope.
Yeah.
But then Captain Mal and Ron Swanson are both, clearly the characters are loved by their creators. They're supposed to be good, you know, they're not supposed to be completely mocked or dismissed.
There's always been inevitable, like, pitfalls of the Han Solo, Captain Mal sort of character, right? They can't just be competent. They have to be competent.
Competent in what?
Be competent, yet also goofy, right? Like, there always has to be those silly mistakes from the I understand that it's a bit of hope, but do you ever notice how like, a romantic loner always has the little failing?
Yeah.
It's fully competent. Han Solo is always the censored star. Mal's always getting caught. Pants down or Christina whatever it is, right? Those characters can't be fully competent.
Yeah, it's true.
I didn't catch most of that because of the microphone.
I mean, I tend to think that if you make a character nothing but like an unrelenting badass, that's a pretty boring character, though. So
right, yeah, then it's a video game of sort of somewhere.
Right, yeah.
But then I am playing a video game. It's not you. The vulnerabilities are necessary for a character.
I think that vulnerabilities are always these goofy vulnerabilities. It's not. It's never just like he makes a down the well.
With Mal, though, I mean, the whole thing was that in the original pilot, he was too dark, and then they hastily wrote the episode "The Train Draw." Yes, I've retained all this information, and Mal is definitely goofier in that, and Mal is also harder in Serenity and more angry, because I guess things are supposed to have not been going so well in the time since the series. So I think that just like the fact that some goofiness or just banter is more accessible to audiences, they think if you're too hard, it's you're scary. I was reminded at one point with a Little House on the Prairie, which I find fascinating. When a couple of years ago this happened, Jezebel, and like a couple of years before that, someone else, people who suddenly discover that Rose Wilder Lane, Laura Ingalls Wilder's daughter, was basically one of the godmothers of modern libertarian thought. And she obviously had a large part in shaping the books, and no one is quite sure how much she did, how much her mother actually wrote. But basically, Little House on the Prairie has this huge, you know, hand, an overtly libertarian person, a huge libertarian person has their hand in these classic children's books. And when they discover that, suddenly they start thinking, oh, the prairie and the West, what libertarian cliches and the self-sufficient pioneers and this horrible narrative of manly patriarchal self-sufficiency. And like they really they're really offended by sort of this idea. Not like the shitty part of like maybe you were stealing land or you were, you know, leading to more of the Indian Wars or like some more legitimate things. No, it's they're kind of offended by this the self-sufficiency of the pioneer type cliche. And like I try to think that, you know, a character who just wants to be left alone, like Captain Mal and other characters, like that's not super political, but at the end of the day, it kind of is. The right to be left alone is actually a very underappreciated and kind of politicized right, I think.
Yeah, separatism is usually seen as a very negative, suspicious thing in progressive circles. I'm never sure why, though. It's sort of the great boogeyman, the separatist out there in Ruby Ridge, or let's kill him with the ATF.
It's all Confederate, I guess, is the idea. I mean, that's part of the suspicion.
Is it the root of it?
I don't know. I would imagine it could be older than that in some ways, but I think that's a lot of it. That's why they're terrified of decentralization in any way. Anything that's not just the federal government keeping a benevolent eye on things smacks of the Confederacy to them. And the fact that in Firefly, again, it's supposed to be, the idea is, you know, they've lost a war, and obviously to us we think of the Confederacy, the book The Killer Angels was supposed to have an influence. That doesn't mean they were all, you know, the Browncoats were all excited about slavery, but they've lost a war. They've lost a war, and the other side was trying to centralize power, and that has that real-world parallel, and that makes the liberals feel awkward.
Does it give them liberal feels?
It does. I think it does. I think we learned that from that essay.
What a terrible piece of writing that was. That got published. Why am I not a writer if that gets published?
It was kind of like their own blog, so I feel like we're kind of almost picking on a small fry. But I don't know. It just there's so many real-world parallels in that piece of writing, so many viewpoints that you can get out of it that this person clearly has that are really distressing.
My favorite line in that article was just, it's an aside in parentheses, I'm just kidding about Mal being a socialist, he's actually a fascist.
Yeah, and what, clearly because fascists, like, the number one beliefs of fascists is to be left alone, like, clearly, right?
That's the central
tenet. That's what they were known for.
Yeah, it's funny because, I mean, Joss Whedon himself has said that Mal is, how do you phrase it, he said, he's a libertarian. Or I think he said Mal's sort of a Republican, if not a Libertarian. Something like that.
I don't think Mal's a Republican. He's certainly a Libertarian.
He's definitely a Libertarian. Like, obviously.
Go on.
I was just going to say, especially seeing as how he's obviously someone who's totally okay with brothels and drugs and black markets.
Yeah. And, like, yeah, I mean, the characters are enough anti-heroes that they've done some sort of edge of morality things. They're not, like, perfect angels. They were robbing a bank in the beginning of Serenity, I guess.
My favorite libertarian sentiment in Firefly is that the air of legitimacy that their enterprise has is they have a sex worker on board. That made me very happy. And, you know, other than Jane, has anyone ever tried to make a move against that as being something dishonest or of ill repute?
Was Jane against it?
He was definitely comfortable.
He was Jane about it.
Yeah.
Mal makes a lot of disparaging comments, but they're just him flirting with Tanara. So.
And being kind of a dick about it, yeah. But like,
he's being mad that she's not doing what he wants him to do. It's not a condemnation of
confession
itself.
Right, it's like we know he's being an immature asshole about it because he's into her, and like it's not supposed to be very flattering behavior on his part, I think. I would like to know is, I mean, we see the whorehouse in one of the final episodes, and then, you know, the evil villain is messing with them. And that's sort of, I don't know if that's supposed to be like an unregistered, you know, like whorehouse, not like the proper companions and stuff. But they seem to be like they're having an okay time and like I mean, like, the respect to the sex workers, does that come just because the Alliance, like, registers the official companions?
Well, actually,
or
yeah.
Everyone kind of accepts
well,
it?
No, because it fits in with a Western motif, too, and they actually had a foothold in society in a lot of frontier towns.
Mm-hmm. Well, but actually, though, in that episode, it's Heart of Gold, Inara actually, how does it go? I think Jane says something like, "Horrors?" And then Mal's like, "No, no, companions." And then Inara's like, "No, no, they're whores. Because they're not registered." So Inara kind of looks down on them a little bit for not being registered, which
she's
is very interesting.
She's a pro-unification scum anyway, though.
Right, exactly.
Right, she is. I mean, so many things that never got resolved. You know, that would have come up in the bantering pre-relationship of Mal and Inara, which is clearly that she's so much more legitimate and so much more pro-government than he's ever going to be. And it's a shame we never got to see how that, you know, explore that and whether Mal, you know, wussed out like Ron Swanson did.
The bad guy in that episode, was he part of the political establishment? Was he like a mayor or...
I haven't watched the episode in too long. I'm going to go rewatch this.
It was something like that. He was... What was he?
Because the idea of sex workers armed with guns shooting up the power elite makes me very happy.
Yeah. Yeah, because he was trying to get, like, his wife was barren, and he was trying to get the child.
You're right, yeah.
I think he was, like, the mayor or something of the local town, because he went there with tons of henchmen.
He's a powerful evil man. I mean, we definitely have that.
I think it's... I was just thinking, interesting, people can have completely different descriptions of anthropology, but they'll have issues in which they... it's like with sex work, one of those ones where people get, but they'll have views that can completely... I think that's always interesting.
Cutting out, I can't hear anything you're saying, and I really want to listen to it.
I know, me too. I got, you know.
If I can disconnect this and mic attach.
I had another. I don't know. We need to kill time while he fiddles with that. I feel like I have important things to say. This is why I don't drink while I host podcasts. If you're a
Are
drunk,
you drunk
guest, it's fine. No, but I'm closer to drunk town than I anticipated being, perhaps.
Comfortably buzzed.
That's the one. I just, like, with that damn essay, like, this idea that there's so many spoilers. I'm actually going to write how many, like, what spoilers are for what fictional things we've discussed when I post this podcast, because there have been so many. But
do we really need to worry about spoiling Firefly, a canceled television show from 12 years ago?
Well, more Serenity, I think. Okay. And if you, you know, but Serenity, the whole thing with the planet Miranda, where they have, you know, placed the peace drug that has killed the planet of, like, 20 million people and has made the space cannibal reavers happen. And in this essay, this fictional, like, just human rights crime.
Totally glossed over.
The writer is downright forgiving of the whole, you know, River has been her brain experimented on, and they've kidnapped her, and they're chasing her down, trying to get her back, basically. It's not like X-Men, where, like, her powers, she's powerful, but she can't, like, control the fucking weather or something, you know? It's not like
she's
this...
dangerous because they made her dangerous.
Right, but she's not, like, all she can do is beat the shit out of a room full of people. She can't, you know, destroy the world. It's not...
I know, but let's dwell on that for a minute. The reason she can do those things physically, and the reason that, these little gaslighting media messages set her off is because the Alliance cut into her brain and made her able to do those things.
But the writer argues it's unreliable. We only get the Mal's side of things and his crew's side of things, which
well,
I guess
why,
is true, but...
Why is the agent murdering everybody? Why are the Hands of Blue murdering everybody that get near her afterwards?
Yeah, it's true. But I mean, the whole, like, an entire planet of people killed. And that's dismissed because that is a mentality like a completely real world mentality. It's that fringe weirdos are trying to wreck everything because they want to be left alone, and that would bring down the government, and then we wouldn't have roads anymore. And that's why we have to forgive Japanese internment and nuking Hiroshima and Nagasaki and bombing Dresden and the Vietnam War and the war on drugs and the prison state. We have to forgive all those things so that we keep having, you know, I don't know, like welfare and maybe not outlaw abortion. There are these trade-offs that liberals, mainstream liberals, make all the time, every single day, and it's all about that. And they will trade war crimes.
Like fucking babies afterwards, too.
What, like babies?
What's it?
Babies? Where?
I said they sleep like fucking babies afterwards, too.
They seem to. They really do. And I mean, that's... Yeah, like, it's not just fictional when you can see, you know, the gears turning in that essay. Like, and that's what they... You excuse certain things so that you can keep the government going. Goddamn, I love Captain Mal!
He's literally my favorite fictional character ever. I relate more to that guy than anybody ever.
Yeah.
My second favorite fictional character is now Rustin Cole from True Detective, if anybody's seen that. Not really libertarian or anything, but it's awesome.
Yeah.
I still have to watch that series.
Me too.
Oh, it's fantastic.
I do enjoy Jericho. I'm going to rewatch Jericho for more libertarian subtext. It's about like a little Kansas town, a bunch of nukes happen in the U.S., and you don't know what's up. It gets more libertarian. It got more libertarian in the shortened second season. And there's some stuff about, like, as the new government begins to kind of grow, it gets more libertarian because, like, the one teenager who has been gathering food and stuff, he has to start smuggling it so it's not taxed. And the villains are old, like, they're basically Blackwater, which is...
Yeah, well, it's also basically Halliburton, and, like, the fake president seems to be Dick Cheney. I think they even say he's from Wyoming. And that brings another libertarian film I'll touch on in a second here. So what's interesting is like they're kind of like they have this thing where it's like, oh yeah, the U.S. military is being maybe not evil but being used wrongly. You know, you have this like evil kind of like corporatist government trying to take over, which almost sounds a little bit liberal. But then there's some very explicit lines in the second season where the mayor, he's like, can you believe it? 200 years of tradition, and just they got rid of the Second Amendment with one vote.
Yes, and like it's that.
Yeah, and it's just like outright. Like, that's like the most pro-gun TV show I've ever seen in my life.
It is everybody except annoyingly the ladies, the lady characters. I wish there were more better lady characters.
Bonnie.
Oh, dude, I love Bonnie.
Bonnie gets gunned down killing, like, federal agents, doesn't she?
Oh, that's right. I love Bonnie. Yeah,
that was hard to watch. Yeah, so she was, like an armed, disabled female character. How often do you see that, like, in TV?
Man, a lot of canceled shows. I wonder why they were canceled.
No. You know what pisses me off most about Jericho? Hmm. Is that it got canceled, and then a few years later, the fucking Walking Dead got so damn popular.
Yeah.
It's like, why couldn't Jericho have just kicked off this post-apocalyptic craze? Now everything has to have zombies in it.
I know.
Completely ruined the post-apocalyptic genre.
I think about going back to The Walking Dead sometimes because the pilot is so fucking good. But like everything I watched after that like went downhill.
I watched like halfway through season two and I was like, this show is retarded.
I stopped season two. Season two was so fucking bad. Oh my god. It was like I'm hanging out with unpleasant people sitting in the woods all day, like bitching at each other. It was so bad.
Talking about Jericho actually reminded me of another film that I think is pretty libertarian and pretty brutal. Is Shooter with Mark Wahlberg.
Have you read that book, actually?
No, I haven't. Was it Point of Impact or something?
Yeah, that is actually quite in terms of media. It's such an interesting character, Wahlberg, to be playing someone who, despite his like bad boy past, manage a
the, like, you know, everything that the Hollywood world can offer, if you're willing to, I made a mistake, if, please forgive me, you know. I just swear, but it is a very interesting film, and the character in the book is even more libertarian, even, and he's even more disaffected from he's actually seen as someone of a major separatist in the book. They don't really do that in the movie. They're trying to get Dan Glover to the right spot as quickly as possible, but they, he's seen as being dangerous and disaffected, and I think he may have actually been dishonorably discharged in the book. I can't remember. It's been about that. Yeah, there's definitely a story that. Have you seen maybe, I don't know if you've seen Jack, awful movie.
What movie?
Reacher.
Oh, Jack Reacher? I thought that was a pretty good movie.
Well, the books are better. The character, and he is actually quite a character.
Yeah, I've read one or two of those of the Jack Reacher books.
Of course, it's interesting. It's written by a British guy, and he seems to have a thing of a type of individual American nail that a lot of American authors lack. I find very interesting. Like, you need to being outside of America lets him view some of these what it's funny, we sort of view like self-determination, self-reliance as these American values that very willingly give them security and comfort of the government. And yet I think people would also, the liberals are just as the pro freedom in air quotes as, you know, Republicans. So
I would dispute that. I think that a lot, at the end of the day, they're the same, but liberals are often more honest than conservatives. Conservatives pretend that they value freedom much more highly than they really do. Mm-hmm. And liberals admit that they value much worse values, equality and niceness and fairness and all these other things that don't work out if you prioritize them. I think liberals can be more honest a lot of the time. They still don't have the necessary self-awareness, but they're not quite as full of shit when they don't go liberty, freedom. They don't have something called Liberty Fest and then have Rick Santorum and John Bolton come to it.
Oh,
you know?
Gosh.
God, I hate them.
Lucy, have you seen the last season of Doctor Who?
You know what? I haven't. I'm behind.
I wanted your opinion because Capaldi's doctor is... He's not flagrantly anti-war, but he's really not a fan of soldiers or the military itself.
Mm. Yeah, that's been kind of
a running...
If you
needed another reason to watch this show.
That was a running thing for at least the last few years that would come up. The doctor was not... He didn't even like guns, like, though, the doctor.
He's hanging out with Winston Churchill. How anti-war can he be?
That's so true.
So how about... back on the subject of TV shows, how about House of Cards? Is it libertarian or is it just a political soap opera? Because I always feel like it hates the government so much, it has to have some kind of sort of libertarian bent to it. And I'm still hoping that, of course, it didn't pop up in season 3 at all, and season 3 was kind of lame. But I'm still hoping that Lucas gets out of jail and teams up with the hacker, and somehow they bring down the whole thing. I think that would be awesome.
I haven't watched the third season yet.
I have not started this show
yet. It's lame.
This show is very overrated because it is kind of, it's just a soap opera. It's not like, I don't know, it doesn't blow my mind. It's enjoyable, especially after they did the thing to that annoying lady journalist character who was the worst.
I'm going to assume you meant they kill the character.
I'm not good at being subtle, I'm sorry. I get really uncomfortable when politicians like Hillary Clinton
saying they killed her is an understatement.
Well, yes. When like Hillary Clinton says, people like that say that they like the House of Cards. I'm like, that bitch, that's not for you. Like, that's that show's about you. That show.
I think Obama like tweeted about it.
Not allowed.
You're not allowed. That's our thing. It's about soulless people trading everything human about them for power. You are not allowed to watch that, Hillary Clinton. Not at all. Not for you.
You think she's taking notes while she's writing it? Or...
Not only that, but like the Frank and Claire Underwood's marriage has to be inspired to some extent by the Clintons.
My boyfriend is convinced of this. Like, whatever, he's convinced of this, and I think there's.
Is your boyfriend like a House of Cards truther?
Well, like marriage, there's like this vaguely asexual affection. Like they're together for power. They like each other, but it's weird. I can see the Clinton vibe. I really can. I don't know. That show is. There's something about that show that doesn't work though. Something about it, its critiques of power are not as serious as I'd like them to be. Maybe because it's such a cartoon that it doesn't seem like they're really saying that power is this bad. I don't know. There's something about it that doesn't quite work for me. But it's still enjoyable. I could talk about this all day and all night. We should probably wrap up, though, as much as this is lovely. If it gets too long, no one will ever watch it, and that will be sad. All right, I want you crazy kids, pimp your wares and your works and your websites, and I will also email them to me afterwards, and I'll include them in things. Adam, anything in the world that you want people to read?
Everything is still in... It's still in pre-production stages, so I have nothing to do.
Okay, so someday maybe. David, pimp the world, the works, the wares.
So. Yeah, the best thing to do if you want to see my work, go to facebook.com/bucktheSystem. Buck the System is the name of my little production company. And through there you can find links to all my work on YouTube. I've made quite a few short films and other miscellaneous videos. Some are very libertarian, some are just short films. Mm-hmm. But hopefully you guys will enjoy those. I need as many fans and supporters as I can get, because I am very adamant about making a serious career as a filmmaker. I really want to take and make the biggest, best libertarian films the world's ever seen.
That sounds awesome. I think we should do a... You and I should maybe do a podcast and talk about... You can sell your wares more to the good people of the internet. So we'll talk to you about that. And you, pimp the something wares, writings, websites, Twitters.
You can find me at Liminal Wanderer on Twitter. You can also find my writing at cinemachicanery.blogspot. There will be more in the future, but right now I'm a little tied up with some real-world job things.
It's no good. The real world's bad.
It sucks. Twitter is so much funner.
Now my question is, should I go watch Jericho or Firefly or Red Dawn? So many choices. I don't know.
Watch one you haven't seen. New York.
I don't know. There are many, too many fine choices. I feel like my attention is divided. All right, wrap this damn thing up. Thank you, Adam and David and Bridget. This has been so much fun. Let's do it again sometime. And I don't know, audience, go look at the Stag blog. Someday I'll write more things. Having some writer's block lately. I'll think about Freedom and Ron Swanson, Captain Malice, and more, and that'll help me. All right, goodbye.